Let's get into it, guys. This is a Q&A. So on my Instagram 2 days ago, I solicited questions from you guys, training questions, nutrition questions, mindset questions, personal life questions, whatever it may be. I realize I haven't done one of these in quite a long time. I feel like you sound like every other Q&A on YouTube. Haven't done one of these. I haven't done one of these in quite a bit of time. And the reality is, especially over on my IG, I just post daily workouts and actually don't use words a lot if you don't watch my story. So people probably see me work out a lot and follow the workouts I do, but don't really know who I am as like a human outside of the hour to 90 minutes I spend in the gym during the day. Like, you know, actual human being over here. So what I'll do is go through the questions that you guys asked. I added them up, actually scrolled through. There was over 600 questions. So we're gonna try to keep this video as fast as I can, get through as many as I can. So I'll stop rambling right now. Last thing, I'll probably split it into two videos just for length purposes. Question number one from Gaith LB, your age, 28 years old. Turned 28 last week. Kaylin Wilson 16, when cutting, should you be decreasing calories and adding cardio? And then she also asked, next question, do you think that a daily step count can take place of traditional cardio when cutting? So start with decreasing calories first, and then add cardio if necessary. Kaylin, let's say that you require 2,000 calories to lose 1 to 2 pounds per week. Start by creating a caloric deficit. So you've created a caloric deficit, you're now eating 2,000 calories a day, and then when your fat loss plateaus or stalls, which inevitably it will be in anyone's fat loss journey, then you can go to introduce cardio. Cardio is simply a tool. Think of the bread and butter is our training and our nutrition, and then cardio is just like the icing on the cake, the strawberry on top, the cherry on top, kind of that type of deal. And then the next thing is, can a daily step count take place of traditional cardio? Sure, so a step count walking during the day is legitimate cardio. So depends on how much you're walking. If you're logging over 5,000 steps per day, that's amazing. And that can totally be counted towards your cardio. Adish asks, best time to take creatine? Doesn't matter, just take it 5 to 10 grams per day, every day, shut your brain off, just know every day you're taking it. And just for habit purposes, as human beings, we're creatures of habit. So take it at the same time during the day, same time at night, same time in the morning. Talk about nutrition, please. Nutrition. Beauty Shot asks, do you offer one-on-one training? I do not do in-person training. I do one-on-one online training. So here's a plug. I have a program called Shred for Life that is kicking off this coming Monday from the time you're watching this video. If you watch it within a day of upload, Monday, August 12th. And this is a one-on-one coaching program. So you can check that out, shreddedforlife.com, or using the link in the description. Christopher asks, what's been your biggest takeaway lesson that's made an impact in your journey thus far? Your biggest takeaway and lesson. So we could go really long here. I'll keep it brief. I'll say, as you get older, you learn that you'll always regret not taking action on something that you wish you took action on. Because as you get more life experience, wisdom, whatever you want to call it, we have the opportunity to look back on more situations and circumstances in the past, because we just have more life, right? We have more life experience. And without fail, it's always, I wish that I took action on that. I wish I tried that. I wish I didn't sell out on myself and defeat myself in my head before I took action and enrolled into some story I was telling myself before I took action. So the biggest takeaway and lesson is, take action on things that interest you and that people are thinking about you much less than you think they are. No one is fucking thinking about you right now. I'm sorry, and that may sound cold, but people, humans, are inherently selfish. We think of ourselves, okay? So if you are so worried about what other people are thinking of you, what you're worried about is actually, like, no one's actually thinking it. It's just you, in turn, kind of being selfish and super self-focused. So at the end of the day, do what you want to, take action on what you want to, because it's only hurting yourself at the end of the day if you don't. And the reality is, if someone doesn't like something that you do and they voice it to you, 15 minutes later, guarantee you they're not thinking about it whatsoever. So how are you gonna let some feedback that's negative that someone gave to you, that they're not thinking about you anymore, 15 minutes later, dictate how you run your whole fucking life? Doesn't really make sense. Screw anyone else that says otherwise, including your family, okay? What's your skincare regimen and what products do you use? So I use really two products, and guys, I would definitely consider myself what society would say metrosexual, which I think metrosexual is you just like to take care of yourself as a man, which I don't think that's a bad thing. I use two products for skincare, really on my face. I really don't do anything for my body necessarily. I don't use like moisturizing lotion on my body, but this is Kiehl's. This is primarily a men's skincare brand. Kiehl's. It is a little pricey, but it is really worth it. I use their staple moisturizer for the face called Facial Fuel. It has broad spectrum SPF 20, it has some UV protection in there. And fun fact, this also has a little bit of caffeine in it. Crazy, right? So I love caffeine so much that I not only drink it, but I rub it on my face. But in all seriousness, this is like one of the best face moisturizers I have ever found. I love it. And then in the shower, I use this deep clean, deep action exfoliating scrub from Clean and Clear, Clean and Clear and Under Control. And it makes your face feel super tingly, and it really absorbs into the skin with steam in the shower. So when you're in like a hot, humid setting, it really sets in there, and then you wash it off before you get out of the shower. And that's my 1-2 punch. How many times a week do you have sex? Yo, okay. So I'm gonna be honest here. So I have gone since April, since like early to mid April, having zero sex. I have not had sex with anyone. And that has been, it hasn't been like a decision. I didn't decide in April, like I am not going to have sex. It wasn't a conscious thing, like no. But I have, I guess in my age, and now that I've turned 28, I've made a decision that I'm gonna save myself for sexual encounters that actually mean something to me beyond just it's a body. Because also full transparency, I've had sex with girls because it's just a body before. And that sounds super cold. Not because it's just a body, it's because I genuinely connect with that human being, but it's been more of a fling, if that makes sense. I'm sure, I mean, you know them, you're acquaintances with them, you're obviously attracted to each other, and then you're out one night, one thing leads to another, and then you kind of hook up. As you get older, at least for me, that loses its excitement because you understand afterwards, you know, I would get empty feelings after having an empty sexual encounter with someone, and I just don't enjoy it, right? And I really do think, not to get religious on you guys, but I really do think it diminishes the quality of the experience that you will have with your significant other when they do come into your life. I do think there is a lot of power in abstaining from that, in being abstinent. So am I saying right now that I'm not going to have sex until I'm married, until I've found the one? No, I'm not saying that, but I am saying that I have drastically reduced the amount of sex that I have been having as to the past. And guys, I want to be clear, I'm not a guy that has sex with hundreds of women. I've not had sex with 100 women. I don't like each week need to get laid or anything. It's not like that. So don't have a takeaway like, oh, he was screwing girls every night and now he doesn't. It wasn't like that, but I've kind of tested myself in the last 3 to 4 months, and I've really enjoyed remaining abstinent. And honestly, I've reduced that, and I really, really do enjoy it. And not only that, guys, but with my competition prep that I undertook, I did cut out alcohol. So for the last 3 months, a little over 3 months, I have not drank alcohol with, you know, and there's a caveat here. After my competition 2 weeks ago, I did have some wine with my mother and my sister in Napa Valley, just because we did like a wine thing. But besides that, it's been no alcohol. And when I say no drinking, like, I'm talking like going out and drinking with the intention to have a good time, get drunk. That has not happened whatsoever. Used to do that in the past, and that's also something with age I'm finding I'm just reducing. And guys, something I've noticed quickly, I know I'm kind of harping on this a lot, but I do feel like a lot of you may find this interesting. With reducing sex and reducing alcohol intake, and when I say reducing, like literally cutting it out, I've noticed the mental clarity to focus on my vision and things that I feel are important. Vision for my life, business, relationship building, building relationships deeper with my family, with my friends, all things business when it comes to client relations with my clients, creating content. It's just gone to another level of focus. I feel like I've been fucking on it. Like just on it, on it, on it, on it. Like wake up during the day, I'm fucking on it. And I'm saying I feel like I've been killing it lately, which I will pat myself on the back. I feel like I have been, just with my own focus, my own energy, and just being excited about what I'm doing. I'm not saying like cutting out sex and cutting out alcohol has been like, that's been the savior, that's been the answer. It's not. There's other factors too, just gaining clarity on life. But reducing these factors and cutting them out has definitely narrowed my focus. And I've been getting the right feedback. You know, these platforms have been growing. My YouTube subs have doubled in the last couple months. A lot of you are new here. Also another reason why I wanted to do the Q&A. So that's my takeaway of no sex, no alcohol. Anyone who does have sex and drink alcohol, you're not a bad person. You're probably a fucking great person. I'm not saying like I'm high and mighty, I'm up on this pedestal because I haven't, but I'm liking this other side. I really am liking this other side. It's neat. it's neat. And I think I don't see it stopping anytime soon. This is the longest I've gone not having sex since my 16th birthday, when I lost my virginity in the back of a car in a middle school parking lot, elementary school parking lot, and it's been great. And also, this is the longest I've gone without drinking alcohol since age probably 19. So, yo. Height, weight, body fat percentage from Kevin. So, 5'9", current weight is probably 193. I ate 8,000 calories last night. I ate a shit ton of food last night. We can talk about why I did that in another video. So that weight is gonna go down over this week. It'll go back down to like 190. And then my body fat percentage, if I had to guess right now, I'm probably sitting around 8 or 9%. Avin Hav asks, sir, what's the average salary of a person in the US, personal trainer in the US? I'm just gonna put it out there, man. You could have Googled this. So, I'll do the work for you. But 33K is the stated from salary.com is the average salary. I find that in-person trainers have a ceiling of how much money they can make. That's why I prefer online, because it's not true. A lot of people think like, ooh, I'm gonna do online because you're gonna make more money. No, that's not the case. But if you are ruthless with your dedication to your business, there is scalability with online that's simply not available for an in-person trainer, Abhinav. So you're trading time for money, right? When you're in a gym, time for money. Client comes in, they pay you $100 for a session, pay $50 for a session, whatever it may be. Well, online, if you set up your business the right way, something called scalability is your time, the time exchange doesn't increase exponentially when it comes to how many more clients you take on. So whether you have 20 clients or 100 clients, your time commitment doesn't shift that much. It will increase a little bit, but you're able to bring in more clients and therefore more revenue with an online business, which is why I prefer it. That's not the question you asked, but it's the answer I gave you for some reason. I do mentor online coaches, so that's why I'm so used to giving this my opinion on online versus in person. Johnny asks, how do you stay motivated? So motivation is something that's really misunderstood. I'm still figuring out motivation myself. I don't have all the answers by any means, but I find something that works for me. And I heard Tony Robbins share this. Tony Robbins is one of my online mentors. Don't know him, but I love him. I owe him so much. Motion creates motivation. So if you want motivation, create motion. So it's in the word motivation, right? Motion. So we think we need to feel motivated to do something, but the reality is we need to do something to feel motivated. So when you don't feel motivated, you've got to get off the couch. When you don't feel motivated to go to the gym, you've got to go to the gym. It's not going to come to you, you've got to seek it. When you go to what you would like to be motivated to do and you just lean into that uncomfortable, fuck, I don't want to do this feeling, and then actually start doing it, I promise you, you can't see it now because you're not motivated, but if you start doing the fucking work, whatever you're avoiding, whatever you're trying to get motivated to do, trust me, suspend your disbelief, just say, I'm just gonna do it for fucking 10 minutes, and I promise you, at the end of that 10 minutes, you are going to be much more motivated and you're gonna want to continue. You'll have created momentum and you'll be off to the races. So I don't always want to go to the gym, but I always go to the fucking gym because when I get there without fail, I'm leaving the gym and I am very happy that I went. You never leave the gym regretting that you went. Remember that. Agyago.11 asks, how many times a day do you poop? So pooping isn't... So again, I had 8,000 calories last night. So I've taken three big you-knows today. It's in direct correlation with how much food you take in, okay? So our bowel movements reduce when we are dieting because we are on lower calories. We're giving our body less nutrition, less just volume of food, and therefore we eliminate less. So it's different for everyone, but understand if your bowel movements are reducing during the day, it's probably normal, especially if you are in a dieting phase. I'd say if you're pooping anything less than once per day, it's probably of concern. I'd say a low bowel movement count per day is one to two. I think a normal would be what, 2 to 3, maybe 4. If you're fast metabolism or in a bulk. How do I deal with depression? I'm gonna try to be quick here. I need to stay in my lane here, guys. I don't want to just throw out a blanket answer here because the truth is there's not a blanket answer. And I hope you guys know, when I share my opinion here, and if it seems like I come off preachy, guys, I know the way that I communicate is kind of strong and it sounds like I have really hard opinions. I'm not in a preachy tone, okay? I'm not preaching at you and trying to indoctrinate you into something. I'm sharing my thoughts and just the person that I am, I guess I inherently have this thing, I would like people to believe what I believe, because I believe as a human being, I believe what I believe sets me up to win in my life. But please understand that these are just my opinions, okay? So I'm sharing thoughts instead of preaching and trying to indoctrinate you into something. That goes with any answer that I give you guys here. So we're on the same level, you watching this. I'm not above you here. We're peers, we're friends, we're just talking, like on an equal level. I would say dealing with the, if you are depressed, I really would recommend going to talk to someone that that can help you with that, that has gone to school and raised their hand and said, it is my passion to help others with depression, because you will be much better set up to win in that situation. And not only that, it could be a chemical imbalance thing where you can be on medication. I don't believe medication is the first answer, but that may be something that is true for you. And last thing I'll say about that, there's no shame in being depressed, okay? It's actually very common, and it's unfortunate. A lot of society thinks, especially on the East Coast, I find, this is general, but as opposed to the West Coast, we think that you go to therapy or get help because you're a broken person. It means that you're broken. Well, you may feel broken, but you go and speak to someone and get what's off your chest to be quote unquote fixed, okay? That's where you go. There's no shame in going to seek help, right? It's a good thing. It's a good thing to seek help. I think a toxic masculinity thing, especially with men in fitness, is like, oh, I'm a one man on an island. I'm self-sufficient. I don't trust others. I can do it all on my own. And that is what drives men, and I'm not exaggerating, to suicide. And because we hold this armor and this face about us where we've got to be strong, and that exact thing can really drive us to some dark places. And I have dealt with suicide in my family, not my immediate family, but I think that was a reason why that was the case. This just got really serious, guys. Wow. Depression's not a joke. Please talk to someone about it, okay? Updated list of your favorite books in general. Okay, number one is High Performance Habits by Brendon Burchard. Number two is 7 Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey. Number three is Obstacle is the Way by Ryan Holiday. Guys, I've been talking so much, I like scatterbrain. Best advice for bettering yourself is the last question. Guys, sacrificing who you are for who you will become. Alyssa DePhillips, my past client, asked that. Alyssa, hope you're doing super well. Best advice for bettering yourself. So I think you kind of answered the question here. This is amazing. So you said, i.e. sacrificing who you are for who you will become. I think that's what you do have to do. So you have to be willing to sacrifice your habits, what you do during the day, places that you go, people that you see, people you surround yourself with, things, destructive habits that you do. Guys, for bettering yourself, there's an activity. Here's an actual activity that you can do really quick. So one of my mentors, Mike Zeller, had me do this, and it was mind-blowing for me. You get a sheet of paper. I'll actually do it for you really quick. Okay, glasses back on, because professor. You draw a line down the middle, and you ask a question, what brings me? What brings me? Life. Death. Kind of dramatic, right? List on this side, 30 things. List on this side, 30 things. All right? So for me, gym, calling mom, coffee, guitar, deep house music, hiking, green juice, right? These are examples. But guys, I'm not even actually joking here. Literally list 30 things, and they can seem stupid, but also on the other side, list things that bring you death. So for me, email, laundry, DMV, scrolling on social media. So list things that bring you death, all right, Alyssa? And then I want you to list 30 things. It's gonna be hard to get 30. You're gonna have to sit there for a while. This may take you an hour, okay? Then I want you to look at the list and just, you have to have self-awareness, okay? So be like a fly on the wall, observing yourself. Just look and ask, Alyssa, what brings Alyssa life? What brings you joy? What brings you happiness, okay? Write those things down. Doesn't matter how silly or trivial you think it is, right? Having a pack of gum waiting for me when I'm in the car, that brings me life. Simple things. Death. You get the gist, right? After you have this list, how can we maximize the things that we do here, have the things that bring you life show up more often in your calendar, and how can we reduce get rid of, delegate the things in our life that bring us death, right? How can we get rid of or reduce these things if at all possible, right? Because a lot of the things we do that bring us death are actually voluntary things that we do, like scrolling on social media, like checking email too much. Generating the awareness will bring you happiness and allow you to become a better person, because I truly believe when we do more things that we enjoy as humans, we show up better for other people. So anyways, guys, I hope you enjoyed today's Q&A. It's definitely long as F, but I have not done one in a super long time. My name is Brian Acosta of shreddedforlife.com. If you are new to the channel, please consider subscribing, dropping your first like, dropping that first comment, and if you have been around for a while, thank you for giving me your trust and your time. Seriously. Thank you for just being here. And if you're new, I hope that you will stick around. And we've got some really cool stuff coming here. I'm always gonna be educating you guys on fitness. Everything that sets me up to win in my life, I find that serves others, always on an equal level as friends. I'm not a preacher, I'm just a sharer. All right, so anyway, subscribe if you're not. I'll see you in Q&A part two. Deuces. Sorry. I hit that corner and I'm bitten, you know. She wanna fuck with list of pity. Put it on that flight and I just sit in, you know.